Good afternoon, everybody, and I'm delighted to be here this afternoon, and it's a great honour to speak in memory of Lyra McKee. And it's wonderful to know that Anne Friel is here, and I'm very glad to say that Lyra's partner, Sarah, and some of Lyra and Sarah's friends from Derry are also with us this afternoon. So it's really lovely to have the honour of speaking in front of all of those people, as well as all of the rest of you. I hope you can all see the screen. I'll be referring back to this particular slide. For Troubles journalists, the term a show of strength means a particular spectacle, and some of you here will be aware of it from seeing these shows of strength on television and so on. It's a spectacle of half a dozen or so men trussed up in army surplus fatigues with masks on their faces and guns in their hands. Journalists get invited to attend these shows, sometimes in hush-hush, nod-and-a-wink sorts of ways, and it's supposed to make you feel as if you've really made it as a war reporter, rather than saying just being a wee girl pretending to be a reporter. So here's some images of shows of strength. These are shows of strength as they were known during the Troubles. And during one of the Drumcree years, I took part in an RTE radio discussion with some leading Orange men about how the marching season puts the heads of young people, and in particular young men, quite astray. And I quoted a Belfast teacher who had told me that it was actually almost impossible to get the boys in his classes to settle down and study for their exams at that summer time of year. And the teacher was concerned, as anyone would be who looks at stats on the underattainment, educational underattainment among working-class Protestant boys. But I was interrupted by one of the Orange men. "This wee girl in Dublin doesn't know what she's talking about," he said. I was about 35 at the time, so maybe he thought I would be flattered. So anyway, these are shows of strength in the traditional manner. You can see that they cross the board. So a show of strength means you stand watching this group of men strut about with guns. Sometimes when they're a bit excitable, shots are fired in the air, and almost always a statement is read in which threats of greater, further, more magnificently vengeful than ever seen before acts of violence against the enemy are promised. And then you write or broadcast about this. Because this is what armies are supposed to do in wars. They retaliate, they escalate, they kill more people, kill better. Trump boasted yesterday he could kill 10 million Afghanis if he wanted. Nowadays in the North, we see mainly shows of strength celebrated in murals on the gable walls of still impoverished after all these years parts of cities, towns and villages. This is one which has been put up by the New IRA. And I don't think it's fanciful or reading too much into things to see this imagery as phallic, do you? Here's Lyra McKee. On the 18th of April this year, she went with her friends to watch a riot in Creggan. She had just tweeted, "Derry tonight, absolute madness," along with a photo of police Land Rovers facing down a small hill towards burning cars and a handful of boys throwing petrol bombs, when she was shot. She was not the target. Like so many of the victims of the North's violence, she was, as we say, in the wrong place at the wrong time. She was a random victim. She just happened to get in the way of a bullet. Police put her in the back of a Land Rover and sped through a burning barricade to get her to Elton McGelvin Hospital on the far side of town. But it was too late. Lyra died. Lyra was from Belfast. She had moved, or emigrated as she put it, to Derry just a few months previously to live with her partner Sarah, a phlebotomist at the hospital. Lyra was in love, she was happy, she was writing. She was only 29 years old and she had everything to live for and a great deal to give. Lyra was a friend of mine. We were supposed to meet that Sunday in Derry. We'd have talked about writing. She'd been sending me chapters of the book she was working on. She didn't really need very much in the way of advice. I was really just mainly encouraging her because she was an absolutely brilliant writer. She had a unique voice, as original in non-fiction as that of Anna Burns, her friend, in fiction. And Lyra was very proud that Anna Burns, who won, of course, the Booker Prize this year, had gone to the same school as her and came from the same area of Belfast. Excuse me. A group calling itself CERU, which is close to the so-called thinking of Republican dissidents styling themselves the Real IRA, put out a statement blaming heavily armed Crown forces for attacking a Republican community and claiming that Lira's death was accidental. They promised to ensure that they would do better next time. Such factions claim to speak for the Republican community and all thrive in the poorest and most marginalised communities, where young people have seen little of benefit from the peace and are readily seduced by the apparent glamour of armed struggle. This is one of the famous bogside murals in Derry. It's now frequently surrounded by tourists. It shows, as you can see, a boy with a petrol bomb in his hand and a Second World War gas mask on his face. It's also just around the corner from a derelict shopping centre where dissident Republicans kneecap boys it finds guilty of antisocial behaviour. It's not far from the River Foyle, into which despairing young men sometimes throw themselves, although the river is also a place that brings great joy with its boardwalks, its clipper races, its fireworks, its peace bridge, its tall ships. Derry is a place of extreme contrasts. It also has the worst demographics for poverty in the United Kingdom, and probably in Ireland as well. A silence fell over Derry after Lira's murder, a silence like the one that fell after Bloody Sunday in 1972, because I remember that one because I was there as a schoolgirl at the time. And through the silence of the Derry streets, 4 days after Lira's death, her friends walked to the headquarters of CERU, and this is what they did. This, to my mind, is a real show of strength. And just look at the stance of those watching warriors standing around them, not knowing what to do with themselves, as we say in Derry, with their arms all the one length. It's such a powerful protest. And this picture shows a member of the occupying Crown forces of Britain kneeling beside one of Lira's friends. He's telling her that if there is a complaint of criminal damages, he may be obliged to caution her. She will extend her arms as if to invite him to handcuff her. He will pat her on the shoulder and walk away. And here is another show of strength. Not in our name, R.I.P. Lira. That appeared on Free Derry Wall in Derry in the days immediately after Lira's death. And here's another. And some of the women who are shouting proudly for pride in this picture are here with us today. The last slide that I'm going to put up is just a lovely picture of Lira. And the rest of my talk, I won't be using slides. The morning after Lira was murdered was the 21st anniversary of the signing of the Good Friday Agreement. I woke to a message from a mutual friend, "So sorry about Lira. My blood ran cold." Soon afterwards, I began to get asked to write about her, and the very first piece I wrote was for The Guardian. I was shocked and upset, and I was furious when I heard the new IRA's deeply offensive apology. I wrote, "Let no one say that Lira died in the name of Irish freedom. Lira was Irish freedom." I have become more and more convinced of this in the days, weeks, and now, unbelievably, 3 months since her death. Her wake was like a vision of the Good Friday Agreement realised. There were people of all ages, all backgrounds, all sizes, all shapes, all colours. These were Lira's friends and these were Lira's people. I call this talk Red Hands of Hope and History because the name invokes Seamus Heaney's wonderful lines that we all know because they've been somewhat overused from The Cure at Troy. History says, "Don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the longed-for tidal wave of justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme. So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a further shore is reachable from here." And I'm using those lines because Lira, like Heaney, saw hope as something far more active than the kind of benign optimism that we usually use the word to mean. Hope to Lira, as it was to Heaney, is an imperative. Hope for a great sea change, Heaney instructs us, and Lira did so too. She was preoccupied with the dark shadow the Troubles continue to cast over her generation, the generation she called the ceasefire babies. In a TEDx talk she gave in 2017, she talked about suicide rates among young gay people. "Don't tell me there is no hope," she said, "because for many young LGBTQ people, hope is all there is." I was delighted to see MP Stella Creasy's abortion amendment and Conor McGinn's MP's equal marriage amendments succeed at Westminster this week, leapfrogging over the stalemated local parties to introduce reproductive freedom for women and the right to marry for same-sex couples. And Stella Creasy echoed Heaney's choice of words when she said that a great sea change had taken place. And Sarah, Lyra's fiancé, said that Lyra would have been over the moon. The American feminist essayist Rebecca Solnit rejects both optimism and pessimism because she considers them to be too passive. She believes that hope navigates a way forward. She has written as well that the true impact of activism may not be felt for a generation. "That alone is reason to fight rather than to surrender to despair," she said. And while I was working on my presentation this morning, I saw a news flash coming in that Boris Johnson had just been made is about to become Prime Minister of the UK. And I was reading yesterday about Trump and his outrageous statement about the Afghanis. So there is plenty of opportunity to surrender to despair, but that makes it all the more important that we listen to Heaney and Lyra and others and hold on to our hope. In her letter to my 14-year-old self, which I urge you to read or watch if you haven't, it has been made into a very beautiful short film. Lyra interestingly adopts the language of struggle. She talks about being bullied at school and says, "It will be journalism that will help you to soldier on." And when she comes out to her mother and her mother says, "How could you have ever doubted that I would still love you?" Lyra says, "You will feel like a prisoner who's just been given your freedom." And actually, it's very funny in the film when she talks about that coming out to her mother, because Lyra was so upset and so anxious that she just sobbed and couldn't get the words out. And eventually her mother says, "Are you gay?" And Lyra says, "Yes, mummy, I'm so sorry." And her mother says, "Thank God you're not pregnant." The red hand, so brilliantly seized on as a symbol by Lyra's friends, is of course mainly used in the North by loyalists. It's used to show Republican dissidents that they had the blood of an innocent young woman on their hands was a wonderful act of subversion at so many levels. I think that one of the challenges for us as journalists, speaking for myself here, and in particular for editors, is that we still have quite conventional ideas about what the words of warfare and struggle mean. I've been surprised to see how little attention has been given in the Irish and Northern Irish media to the great human rights victories won suddenly after decades of campaigning this week. I don't think that the vote in Westminster was even covered on the news on BBC Radio Ulster that evening. The news agenda has not adapted to a post-conflict situation in which non-violent events are momentous. Nor have we appreciated properly that there are different ways of looking at leadership. Who among us knows the names of those who led the Black Lives Matter movement, for example? Hardly anyone, I think. They are, in fact, black women who didn't think that the most urgent issue was to put their names in lights. Mary Robinson, the former president, said of the late great civil rights campaigner Inez McCormack, that Inez had taught her that sometimes you could be more effective if you didn't feel the need to take the credit. Historian Mary Beard says that if women are to be included in history, we need to look at leadership as being about more than just the single charismatic male figure. We need to think collaboratively and about power as the ability to be effective, to make a difference to the world. In 2014, Lyra wrote about a row which erupted in the North after a nationalist councillor described himself as an economic unionist. He was reprimanded by his party, the SDLP, and Sinn Féin said that he was clearly not a nationalist at all. Lyra wrote in his defence, "I'm nearly 24. I'm from a mixed religion family but was baptised Catholic, and I grew up in a Republican area. I'm the kind of voter Sinn Féin might target. Yet I won't vote for them or for the SDLP. While they bicker with unionists and worry about a united Ireland, I'm worried about paying this month's bills. I've had to adjust to a world in which there is no job security. It's hard to make a living. Meanwhile, the politicians who supposedly represent me are arguing about a constitutional issue I have absolutely no interest in. The Good Friday Agreement has created a new generation of young people freed from the cultural constraints and prejudices of the one before. This is still Lyra talking, by the way. It used to be that being a unionist or nationalist was an accident of birth. You didn't decide whether you were for the union or not. The decision was made for you. Your friends were drawn from your own kind. Looking at my own social circle, it's clear how times have changed. Whilst our politicians debate issues connected to the past, we have moved on. The constitutional debate is irrelevant. It doesn't pay the bills. It doesn't get new laws passed. It doesn't improve life in Northern Ireland in any tangible way. And here's how she concluded that piece. Whilst I saw the tail end of the conflict, I didn't see enough of it to make me bitter towards the other side. I saw enough that peace and moving forward seemed like the only options. Most children of the Good Friday Agreement generation, those born after 1998, or who were relatively young when the agreement was signed, saw no conflict at all. Slowly, a common consensus is emerging, the belief that the union versus a united Ireland argument should be left to die. It's holding us back. It reminds us of days past. I don't want a united Ireland or a stronger union. I just want a better life. And Katie Hayward, who's here today, has just recently published some, along with Cathal McManus at Queen's, some really interesting research which shows that something like 50% of people in the North now say that they don't define themselves as being either nationalist or unionist. And the biggest growth, and that number is growing rapidly, and I think that's to do with exactly the kind of disaffection with traditional views of politics and sovereignty that Lyra is talking about there. I think that Lyra was a very authentic voice for working class Irish millennials. There was nothing entitled, nothing snowflakey about her. Stella Creasy has pointed out that politics is also about issues that are ignored as well as issues that are aired. And often the issues that are ignored are issues that are of concern to and articulated by women. Senator Mark Daly from the Republic has just spent nearly 2 years working on a report about what Northern Unionists fear about the notion of a united Ireland. It was a very honourable enterprise. However, he managed to do so without consulting a single woman. Leaving women out inadvertently has the same impact as leaving them out deliberately. It means their voices are not heard. And I must address the next comment to Joe, and it's a benign one, don't worry, Joe. I made some remarks about this in relation to the McGill School last year, and I must say it was very gracious of Joe and of the committee to invite me to speak this year. And they have had some magnificent women on the programme this time around, and some still to go. And incidentally, anybody who's concerned about panels which are not balanced, the Irish website, the Irish organisation Manel Watch has a really good tool for actually checking out conferences and making sure that they do have a proper gender balance. It isn't enough just to have a couple of women selling the tickets. Adrian Rich, the great poet who died just a couple of years ago, wrote in the 1970s that, quote, "The entire history of women's struggle for self-determination has been muffled in silence over and over. One serious cultural obstacle encountered by any feminist writer or activist is that each feminist work has tended to be received as if it emerged from nowhere. So also is each contemporary feminist theorist attacked as if her politics were simply an outburst of bitterness or rage." Not that we don't engage in outbursts of bitterness and rage as well, but you get the point. Rebecca Solnit points out that the traditional models of power and authority create an impossible bind for women. Women who aspire to power can't be too feminine, she writes, since femininity is not associated with leadership, but nor can they be too masculine, since that is not their prerogative. They are forced, she says, to be something impossible in order not to be something wrong. This has been the case for many years in Ireland, and I would argue that it's quite a strong part of our cultural identity in contemporary Ireland. Mary Josephine Ryan from Leitrim lost her partner Sean McDiarmid to the Easter Rising in 1916. As her contribution to a book called The Irish Rebellion of 1916 and Its Martyrs, she described her last meeting with him in Kilmainham Jail just hours before he was executed. And this is a quote from what she wrote. At 4 o'clock that Friday morning, when the shooting party had done their work, a gentle rain began to fall. I remember feeling that at last there was some harmony in nature. These were assuredly the tears of my dark Rosaline over one of her most beloved sons. There's something about her language in this piece that I find self-sacrificing. She obliterates her own feelings as a woman whose lover has just been executed, her hopes and dreams, her fears, her pain. She steps aside, handing him over to Ireland. My dark Rosaline weeps for another martyr to her cause. The problem for real women of the identification of Ireland as a nation with the female is something that the poet Evan Boland has explored in the context of trying to find her own authoritative voice as a poet who is Irish and a woman. Boland writes about her life as a young woman who came back from America to Dublin as a student in the 1960s. She's trying hard to find a place for her own poetic voice, but all she finds in Irish poetry is a rhetoric of imagery which alienated me, a fusion of the national and the feminine, which seemed to me to simplify both. She felt that it represented a political aspiration or a collective fantasy, an archive of defeat or a diagram of victory. Ireland was a woman, Irish poetry was male, Irish poets were male. Women in the poetry of nationalism were, she said, passive, decorative, raised to emblematic status. These distorted images of women had their roots in real and suffered experience, and Joe has referred to that in his introduction when he talked about the women from this area who suffered through the famine and who suffered through emigration. Boland describes meeting on Achill Island with an old woman in a cardigan who points out to her a beach where she tells Boland people tried to find seaweed to eat during the famine. It's quite extraordinary to think that, you know, that's in the lifetime of a living Irish poet that she met such an old person. What happened, Boland asks herself. How had the women of our past, the women of a long struggle and a terrible survival, undergone such a transformation? How had they suffered Irish history and rooted themselves in the speech and memory of that Achill woman, only to emerge in Irish poetry as fictive queens and national sibyls? She came to see the notion of Ireland as a woman, my dark Rosaline, Kathleen Na Houlihan, Mother Ireland, as a dispossession of Irish womanhood, a simplification which negates complex feelings and aspirations. She becomes the passive projection of a national idea, she wrote. Lyra wrote in her letter to my 14-year-old self, it gets better. And it did get better for Lyra in her short lifetime. In a later talk, she said, it gets better for those of us who live long enough to see it get better. She was 24 when she wrote the letter, 27 when she gave the talk in which she said, it gets better for those of us who live long enough, 29 when she was murdered. President Michael D. Higgins said, it is as if truth itself was murdered. Patrick McGill's fictional character Moleskin has a saying, there's a good time coming, although we may never live to see it. Young people in the North are constantly told to remember their martyrs, remember 1916, remember the hunger strikes. It's time to remember and to learn from someone who had a radically different idea of freedom. Remember Lyra. Lyra McKee did not die for Irish freedom. Lyra was Irish freedom. Thank you.